just wanted to, you know, the focus that I wanted to have a little bit was just to provide a quick overview of the worldwide data protection and cybersecurity regulation in the context of litigation. As my colleague said, I work for Etihad Aviation Group, and we have Etihad Airways, obviously, is an international airline, but we also have stakes in Alitalia and Air Serbia and Air Berlin. So we have a very sort of a wide portfolio of airlines, and we have to deal with a lot with the U.S. laws and also the European laws. But one thing that I wanted to just say, just to sort of set the perspective, privacy and data protection is probably one of the hottest areas of the new emerging areas of litigation. Back in U.S., before I moved here, I used to work for Microsoft, and then prior to that, I was at Target Corporation. And a few years ago, Target had a massive data breach, and it didn't happen on my watch, but it happened after I left. But the cost that Target has acquired thus far, it's around $200 million in terms of litigation costs, in terms of compensation costs to the data subjects, as well as the banks, $200 million. And it's really caused the CEO and the chairman of the Target to basically resign, and their entire IT security team to basically move, and they have a whole new set of people. So it's huge, and especially in U.S., we happen to be a pretty, society that loves to litigate, and we actually have a lot of private action lawyers who actually make 40% contingency on filing suits on behalf of other clients. So it's sort of a little bit different system compared to Europe, but it's very important, and it's as an in-house counsel, it's very important for people to sort of focus on these things and make sure that we, try to take steps to minimize bad things happening, but also try to minimize the effects of litigation. But just in general, the if you look at the worldwide privacy and data protection cyber crime laws, there's probably about 100 different jurisdictions with 100 different laws. In US itself, we have out of 50 states, 40 states have their own privacy and data protection regulations. And then you have litigation regulation around healthcare, such as HIPAA. Then you have regulations around children, which is COPPA, then financial services, and then each of the sectors have their own. Europe itself has been a sort of, the European Union has been a sort of a key leader in privacy and data protection. The last legislation that was passed was the 95 directive, and then each of the member states have since enacted their own member state laws. And then most recently, this last year, they passed a new European General Data Protection Law, which basically seeks to implement consistent rules across Europe. And as litigators, you'd probably be interested that, and as also in-house counsel, the fines, the administrative penalties for violation of the EU Data Protection Law can range up to 2% to 4% of your worldwide revenue. So imagine if you're generating $1 billion in revenue, it's huge. The fines can be massive. Plus, the EU data protection also introduces a new concept, which is sort of a similar concept in U.S. as a class action. Basically, it allows associations to file lawsuits on behalf of the people who are aggrieved. So just imagine, the associations cropping up, the Association for the Protection of Digital Rights and these things. So Europe, in terms of U.S. has been historically very expensive in terms of data protection issues. Europe is probably about to get more expensive. And then if you look at around the world, there's Latin America, each of the countries have their own different regulations. Brazil has its own, Colombia has its own. Very similar to how the Europe has been addressing data protection issues, although some of those jurisdictions have basically a concept of data residency, meaning you can't take your data in and you can't take it out outside of the country without getting permissions, which is a similar concept we have in Europe as well. And then if you look at other countries, Australia has its own data protection law, very similar to Europe. And America's, Canada has its own called PIPEDA, which is very similar, actually more restrictive than Europe. and huge penalties. The Canadian regulator, Canada has a new law around prevention of unsolicited emails, and it was passed 2 years ago, and the Canadian regulator has just recently imposed a million dollar fine on a business that was just sending just a few hundred unsolicited emails. So the fines and penalties can be stiff, and obviously as a litigator, when that happens, you have to choose what the facts are and whether you actually want to litigate against the government agency or not. In some cases, it may be worth it. We at Microsoft, we litigated against the European Commission for 10 years, so we kind of know how it feels, and it cost us hundreds of millions of dollars, and in the end, we still got a $1 billion fine, so it didn't quite work out the way we wanted, but, you know, it's okay. It's business. And similarly, you know, in Asian countries, Singapore, Hong Kong, a lot of these jurisdictions have penalties around data protection violations, cyber crime violations, and they also have, in some cases, criminal liabilities, in the case of Singapore. In UAE itself, where we live, and the place, it's my adopted home for now, we don't really have a general data protection regulation, but there is a regulation around keeping private data private and not actually sharing it with other people without permission. And actually, there's some case law around it, and you can actually go to jail if you share somebody's private information without their permission. In terms of jurisdictions, so in Dubai, we have the DIFC that has its own data protection rules, which are very similar to European 95 directive. And then in Abu Dhabi, we have a new jurisdiction. It's kind of a free zone. It's called the Abu Dhabi Global Market, similar to DIFC, and they have their own data protection rules in terms of their model, very similar to US and European rules, but in terms of taking permissions and working with the regulator, they impose a huge amount of penalties. So really, if you sort of step back and you look at, if you're a global company, so for example, at Etihad or Microsoft or you know, one of Emirates, if you're a global company and you're dealing with personal data and cybersecurity issues from around the world, it can get quite complicated. And really, what you need to do is a risk-based analysis. Obviously, you know, as lawyers, we on a daily basis, we advise clients on what to do, what not to do. When it comes to data protection, cybersecurity, there is a lot of gray, and then there is a red, and obviously nobody wants to cross the red line, but within the gray line, even, you know, between, you know, white to gray line, the risk analysis as an in-house counsel depends, we tend to do a lot of jurisdictional-based analysis, right? And which means more time, which means more resources, but in some cases it may not be worth it, but in a lot of cases it is worth it, because the kind of things that you can do, for example, in GCC, are not the kind of thing, and with a fairly low level of risk, are not the kind of thing that you may be able to do in US or Canada. And the same thing, the kind of things that you're able to do in US and Canada, you may not be able to do in Europe. And in this sort of world today, where we're dealing with digital information, we're dealing with websites, we're dealing with mobile apps, we're dealing with really big data in terms of business wants to collect the data from everybody. They want to know who you are, what you buy, where you go, what things you like, you know, who are your friends, where you live, you know, where do you spend your money, so that they can custom tailor, you know, build a profile on you and then start to market you. I mean, that's a huge data set that many businesses carry, including Etihad Aviation Group, and really, it's our responsibility to protect that data, and it's our responsibility to make sure that the data is being used within an acceptable level of risk across the world. And you know, and the way to do that is to have a very, you know, the way we have it structured, that we have a our group-wide data protection and cybersecurity policies. There's a legal department that deals with this. There is also a compliance department that provides on a day-to-day controlled and compliance guidance. And then we have a very strong security program, because one of the obligations, for example, the FTC, the U.S. Federal Trade Commission, has fined companies 10, 15, up to $30 million if there is a data breach and the companies are not able to demonstrate that they have taken what they call reasonable and appropriate steps. It's just one law, one line in the law. But if you look at what the reasonable and appropriate means, it's you know, literally hundreds of pages of you know, rules around technical measures, organizational measures, other security measures. So you really got to make sure that you know that you actually, if God forbid something happens and you're in court and you have to demonstrate that you did take all reasonable and appropriate steps, that you can actually go to the court and demonstrate that to them. And actually it creates a defense for you. The other thing that we've learned and learned in the past is, and I think we discussed it, is this email. You know, that when something blows up, there's a lot of emails, and now it's WhatsApps and IMs and everything else. And the challenge around that is, in, as I just communicated, in US, as long as I can tag it attorney and client privilege and I can make a reasonable case that it is an attorney-client work product, I can keep that out of the discovery. But in Europe, that's not necessarily the case. So, you know, my advice, and especially in data protection and cybersecurity, it's a very fact-based analysis. So usually when an incident happens, you'll have a team of engineers and IT security specialists and internal auditors, and they will go in, and usually they love to communicate over email. And a lot of times they will communicate facts such as, we were supposed to do these five things, and our internal teams did only three, and they failed to do two. Now just imagine if your internal reports get produced in a European court, and or a U.S. court, I mean, your chances of winning the case are pretty much low, right? So low is probably not the right word, the zero. So it's a challenge. I mean, it's a challenge that we all have, because it's almost impossible. Well, first of all, even if there was privilege, it's almost impossible to chase people and say, well, everything you send it to me first, and then I will put privilege on it, and then you send to other people. That's just not the way companies work. That's not the way corporate communication works. So the best advice there is, if it's bad, don't write it down, pick up the phone and call. But you know, practically speaking, it's a very hard thing to enforce. So I'd say privilege, trying to maintain privilege, trying to not have written documentation, especially when you're at fault, or at least when it's there, then you try to somehow protect it. And to an extent possible, maybe destroy it in a few years, and then making sure that you have right policies in place that you can demonstrate to the regulator and courts that you've done that, making sure that you have right evidences in place, that you've taken the time to implement training, that you've implemented reasonable and appropriate technical and security measures or whatever that happens to be. And that those are all the defenses that can help when things blow up. So with that, I got the time sign, so I will go back to my chair. But I'm sure there will be questions afterwards. So.
Thank you very much, Shahab.